Humans have a long-standing fascination with seeing our creations come to life. We've been at it for millennia. Remember the ancient myth of Pygmalion, the sculptor so enchanted with the woman he chisels that goddess Aphrodite brings the sculpture to life? We never seem to tire of the concept, and it might be because these stories raise such fundamental questions about what it means to be alive and what it takes to think and to feel.
It's alive!
But these questions aren't reserved for fiction anymore. We're facing them in real life, through the field of artificial intelligence. In 1770, an Austrian inventor premiered his so-called Mechanical Turk, a supposedly intelligent automaton dressed in a European conception of Turkish clothing. The automaton played chess, and for decades, the machine delighted audiences throughout Europe and the Americas, beating the majority of its challengers, including Benjamin Franklin and Napoleon Bonaparte. The secret was simple. The intelligence was inside the machine. Hiding inside the cabinet, which people could inspect, was a person, a living, breathing chess master who operated the automaton and defeated the opponents. In the last 250 years, we've made a lot of progress. Robots can amaze without a person hiding inside. But the people creating artificial intelligence today still face deep questions about what intelligence means and how we know when we've created it. In this video, we're exploring what artificial intelligence, or AI, is. We're talking about the differences between how computers and people process information, and we will see some AI in action.
AI is the demonstration of human-like intelligence in machines. It was first coined in the 50s, and people continue to debate what artificial intelligence is and is not, both among the general public and among computer scientists.
And now, machines really can play chess.
Chess, for a long time, was considered sort of a pinnacle and marker of intelligence because it's kind of highly reasoned, only people can do it. And to have a system that in this very sort of constrained rules-based world can best human intelligence and can demonstrate what we considered to be sort of a pinnacle of intelligence, sort of forced us in a lot of ways to rethink what intelligence is and then what artificial intelligence is within that.
Being smart is knowledge, but it's also knowing how to use knowledge. And that combination is what we look for.
One way that scientists have attempted to define artificial intelligence is through the Turing test, named for its creator, pioneering British computer scientist Alan Turing, who began his work in the 1940s.
So the basic idea is this. I am talking to you right now, and the reason I think, according to Turing, the reason I think that I'm talking to a human being and not a computer is because I get into a conversation and you give me answers that are meaningful. In response to my questions and vice versa. The basic idea, therefore, is that if we were having this conversation not face-to-face, but using a computer terminal, and I didn't know whether on the other side of the terminal there was a human being or a computer program, if the conversation keeps going and I still can't tell the difference, and it turns out that it is, in fact, a computer software, a piece of software that is on the other side of my terminal, then I would have to agree that that piece of software is intelligent, that computer is intelligent. I think this is flawed for a variety of reasons. Number one, because you can actually fool human beings very easily.
People disagree about using the Turing test as a marker of intelligence. Susan Epstein provides a different framework.
The way I teach about artificial intelligence, I talk about something we call an agent. An agent is simply a device or an object or a being that does three things over and over again. It senses its world, perceives it. It makes some sort of decision based on those perceptions. And then it takes an action based on that decision. And then it starts all over. Sense, decide, act, over and over again. That loop can be implemented a lot of different ways. Now, people are really good at this because we have a lot of ways to perceive the world. We can see, we can smell, we can taste, we can hear, we can touch. And all those abilities are what you would think of for a computer as input devices. They're ways of getting information in. And it appears, at least to us, that we seamlessly integrate all this data that's coming in, and we just sort of know what's going on. If you speak to a computer, it's quite different from if you feed it text. There is all this noise in a signal, as you probably know.
We often hear scientists talk about signal versus noise. This is a data analysis skill that scientists use when interpreting observations and results. And it sounds technical, but in fact, we do these calculations every day. Think of what it's like to be in a large classroom as you try to focus on your teacher's lesson. All around you, there's noise. And it doesn't have to be just sound. There are visual distractions, too. Any irrelevant information counts as noise. You try to filter out all this extraneous information around you and focus on the signal, your teacher's lecture. It's tough even for humans, and we practice this skill every day of our lives. Now imagine trying to teach a computer how to do this. How do you teach a computer what to pay attention to and what to ignore? In our robotic heroes and villains, we like to imagine sophisticated, autonomous machines with lots of skills and their own personalities. But here's what they look like in real life.
You're asking me to go to room 590 up for the 20, is that correct?
Yes.
The goal was to really have it completely autonomous. Nobody following it, nobody checking, just letting it go down the corridors by itself and just by itself. So that was a major thing for us, because a lot of these experiments had been done in the past and are still being done, but people follow these just to make sure. So how do we go from not following a robot to just let it go? Right? To what is this difference? And so it happened that no matter what, when we send it, it always got stuck somewhere. And it was like either a chair that was not on its map, or a person that hit the robot, or God knows what. So it became a little bit of a frustration to understand that this robot was always never going to be able to be by itself. At one point, I realized that this is it. We still are going to have to deploy this thing. And I conceived this concept of symbiotic autonomy, in which the robot asks for help. COBOT stands for collaborative robot. So it became collaborative because it's not really capable of doing the whole thing by itself. It doesn't understand everything you say up front. But it asks, keeps asking, and eventually converges to knowing more and more by asking. Actually, it also goes to the internet. So if I say, bring me coffee, it's going to say, what is coffee thing about? Goes to the web. So it has these external resources. It talks with other robots in the building. We have four of them at Carnegie Mellon. It just changed the paradigm, this concept of not having to do it all by yourself. So it's still autonomous, but it can ask for help. So that's why we feel so strongly about this co-part, co-bot, because it's collaborative with humans, with the web, and with other robots.
As cobots move around the building doing tasks, delivering things, escorting people, they can also collect data about the environment, like the strength of the wireless signal in different areas of the office, or temperature in the office throughout the day.
For a person, it's very hard to actually acquire these detailed maps. And so you have this machine that, you know, tediously also goes over and over and then creates probabilistic averages, does not take one measurement and knows it all. This robot has moved like for kilometers in the building over at different times, many samples. It goes and it goes and it goes. It brings all that knowledge from tedious repetition and accurate localization in the building that then humans can use to make decisions about allocation of resources, about
where to put another router.
Cobots can understand speech. But how do you get a machine not only to understand words and sentences, but also subtext? That is, how the meaning changes based on how the words are spoken.
Currently, speech recognition does a pretty good job of recognizing the words you're saying, but generally ignores a lot of the inflection and intonation, which carries a lot of meaning for a human being but unfortunately, machines are currently not making particularly good use of.
Our natural language is inherently ambiguous. Such as if we say something like, I see a boy playing in the park. So that sentence itself is inherently ambiguous, that which is not clear, are we referring to I am in the park, or are we referring the boy is playing in the park? So they are like interesting problems that we get into. And if we try to get the machine to actually exhibit human intelligent behavior, then what we actually would like the machine to be able to do is not just about cranking numbers, solving a specific problem, but actually try to go solve problems that we may not know very well how to solve it ourselves.
Humans are pretty good at sorting through messy data, separating signal from noise, and combining lots of different data streams to get a contextualized picture of the world. Researchers say if we want to replicate some of those skills in machines, one approach is to start by better understanding ourselves.
First of all, we actually don't know very well how we do it ourselves.
Knowledge representation is a really essential piece of AI. It's how we describe our world, which is so different to a computer, in a way that it can capture it.
Hi, Cobot. Go to the kitchen.
You are asking me to go to room YK1943, is that correct?
Yes.
K1943. I have done with my task. Please press the run button.